please excuse my voice. I'm still sick, so if it go in and out, I'm so sorry. I'm trying to get this video out to y'all. I know they hate to see me coming, but these little bitches, game is over. They done. This is what we want. This is where we want this case to go, because I guarantee you it's going to be more charges than that. Mm-hmm. Y'all said they're going to laugh at Kenneth Petty exhibits and documents, and look where hers went to. Mm-hmm. His documents and exhibits are going to cancel that bag and bring more charges. Watch what I say. So, just enjoy this video. Talk to you guys later. Bye.
That they're going to file a motion to dismiss because this lawsuit makes no sense against Nicki Minaj. She was contacted, according to her lawyers, sometime in 2018 by this woman and her agents looking for money. And so in the course of that, she has been speaking on the lawsuit and addressing the lawsuit because they came to her for money.
Zoo's information started floating around the internet. Well, the person that sent it to Daily Mail in the blast was not Corey, it was me.
What?
Yes, it was me.
Not you, Queen Kate, not my Queen Kate.
So, but I'm private, so.
Okay.
I'm extremely private. So, when I sent his court, the court documents, because of the comment, the salacious comment that the entertainer Nicki Minaj posted on her page because she was being attacked by some of her, I'm gonna use this term loosely, her fans and other people, and claimed that the victim was his girlfriend. So that prompted me of the investigation.
People don't know, but I didn't reach out to Daytime Tea Time. You know, my aunt, Sunday Grayson's aunt, rather, you know, her blood aunt, reached out to Daytime Tea Time.
Revealed that Kenneth Petty was a registered sex offender. And in 2018, the woman that he allegedly offended contacted me, and we had a very...
I was really hoping that, you know, it would kind of die down. Like, you know, I wasn't really interested in telling my story because I felt like, you know, it was already told. You know what I'm saying? Like, with him being arrested and going to jail, and granted, he didn't go to jail for rape, but he would have to register as a sex offender.
Because I felt like my story had already been told. He went to jail.
Yeah.
He went to jail, he got arrested. Whatever plea deal he took, I wasn't even in court long enough to even know that he took a plea deal. To even know he had, I didn't know he had to register as a sex offender until recently.
So what, you were just visiting in New York and just kind of seeing him?
No, I had actually moved back to New York. I had moved back to New York probably... and like the end of 98. I moved back to New York because I had my son in 97. So I had moved back to New York then.
The knife that I told them about.
Yeah, you know what I mean? About the knife. What did he do with the knife with you? Did he use it on you?
He did, but he didn't stab me. What he did was he held it to my stomach, you know, trying to push me back. Like, every time that I would get up off the bed, like, when I would try to get up before I gave in, like, when I was fighting with him, when he first pushed me down and I tried to get up, he grabbed the knife off the dresser.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like a basic, you know, it was like a basic butcher knife, you know, like one of those thick knives or whatever have you. And I remember him grabbing at my pants, and he pulled me closer, and the knife was, like, pointing at my stomach. And he tried to use it to lift up my shirt, you know what I'm saying? And to use it to you know, like, rip my pants open. But instead, he cut my stomach.
Oh, wow. So that's how he cut your stomach. Because I did see that on theblast.com, you know, with the police records, it did say, you know, that he put a knife against your stomach. So, wow.
He said he was going to school, too. I might have said something like, yeah, right. And I turned away from him to look for... We had dollar vans mm-hmm. back then. Mm-hmm. So I was looking for the bus or the dollar van. And before you know it, he was grabbing a hold of my jacket.
Jennifer, what happened after he grabbed you?
I felt something in my back. So I just assumed there was a gun. Okay. And I started walking. And I'm pleading with him the whole way. I'm trying to understand what does he want, and we get in front of this house. It might have been maybe the second or third house from the corner, and he kind of reaches behind me with his foot to push the door open, and he pushes me up the steps. We walk up the steps. I'm crying because now I'm inside. We walk up the steps, and I'm continuously pleading with him. I'm asking him, like, what do you want? Like, if you just want me to chill here with you, I will. And then he said I knew what he wanted. He pushed me down on the bed. We wrestled for my clothes. Because all I could do was hold my pants like this, as tight as I can. I don't know why it didn't dawn on me to like really fight. I just held on to my pants, and he'd hold my arms down, and he squeezed the sides of my stomach so hard. And so I'd let go, and as soon as I let go, he'd grab my pants. It was like a tug of war. After a while, I just got tired. And I just felt maybe if he hurry up, you know, I could just hurry up and leave. After he got off top of me, he stood in the mirror and he beat his chest. And he said, I'm the man, I'm the man. And so I'm asking him, please let me go. I won't tell nobody. And he just was into the mirror. He just, into himself. And he went to light a cigarette. And I thought maybe, like, you know, I seen a roll of toilet paper on the dresser. And I thought maybe if I liked a cigarette, I could get the match to set the toilet paper on fire. And it went out. I squirted his contact lens cleaner in his face, and he was like, thank you for wiping my face. And he just washed the water, and at that time I just seen this big plastic bottle, almost like the bleach bottle, sorry, and I just took it and swung it at him with all my might. And when he went to duck, I pushed him, and he fell in between the beds, and I just ran, and I just kept running, and just kept running.
We would not be here but for the actions of Kenneth Petty and Nicki Minaj. The lawsuit deals with two things. First, it deals with the crime of 1994 when Kenneth Petty raped Jennifer. And it also deals with the actions of 2020 when Nicki Minaj and Kenneth Petty decided to send their associates to Jennifer and harass her for a 7-month span to get her to recant her story from 1994 in order to get him off of the sex offender registry. So the lawsuit deals with harassment, intentional infliction of emotional distress, sexual harassment, sexual assault.
Jennifer, what kind of harassment do you allege that you faced?
There was an associate of Kenneth and Nicki Minaj who came to the state that I was living at. I've been harassed by people calling family members that I haven't even spoken to or seen in quite a while, offering money, phone calls from different people in regards to this supposed letter that I written. People approaching my daughter. People approached her in a club and asked her about Kenneth Petty, and she wasn't even born at the time that this happened. So, yeah, it's been pretty awful.
Jennifer, have you ever spoken to Nicki directly?
I did, in March of 2020. She called me, and she said that she got word that I was willing to help them out in a situation that I didn't understand what she was referring to. She offered to fly me and my family to L.A. I turned it down, and I told her, woman to woman, this really happened. And I hadn't spoken to her since.
Now, you allege that Nicki and Kenneth were harassing you. In what way?
With them sending people to negotiate numbers as far as money is concerned with family members. And Nicki is the one who personally reached out to me. She's, you know, in regards to helping them in this situation. And then the threats that I received because I kept saying no to every offer, to every suggestion. The last incident was when one of their associates put $20,000 on my lap, and I still kept saying no. The last message I received was that I should have taken the money because they're gonna use that money to put on my head. And then I just cut off everything, changed my numbers. I moved multiple times, relocated from away from my children because I didn't want anything to come back and affect them. So I've kind of been in fear for the last year.
This associate that she's referring to, this is the same guy who recently posted an Instagram video threatening to either kill or to do bodily harm to Jennifer. And this post came literally 6 days after Kenneth Petty accepted a plea deal here in California for failing to register as a sex offender. This is the same guy that showed up at Jennifer's house with the $20,000 and put it on her lap with a pre-written recantment statement that he tried to force her to sign on behalf of Nicki Minaj and Kenneth Petty. This is the same associate that that sent Jennifer a text message from Kenneth Petty with Nicki Minaj's phone number, informing her that this is the number that you will receive a call from.
So this narrative of Black being schizophrenic and just kind of just being a clout chaser and you guys planning this thing to and him coaching you and you asking him, you know, what does he want you to say? You know, that's
okay,
all.
So that coaching thing, right? So that's going to be with this 6-second clip, Hotshot, do you remember?
Yeah, the
2-second clip that Tasha K posted on her.
Or like a lawyer or something,
uh-huh.
You need to tell what to write.
I said there was a mutual friend
who had connected with me, who said he can connect me with them, he offered me $20,000 because he thought that he'd be doing Kenny a street favor.
Told me was that she got word that I was willing to do something to help them out in this situation.
Where did the word from the person that
that's came- how she worded it.
Huh. Okay.
So basically the middleman, the person who contacted me, he's the middleman.
Right.
So the middleman is offering me supposedly $20,000 from his pocket. Right? Like, this is a street favor. You know, this is.
I don't know if Kenny reached out to Black. I don't know if Nikki reached out to Black. I don't know how that happened. I don't know how, what the conversation was for Black to even contact me to. Okay. When I spoke to Nikki, only thing I reiterated was, I need you to know, woman to woman, this happened.
And what did she say?
And she was like, well, if you ever need anything, if you want to call, you know, this is my personal number. You can reach out at any time. After that phone call, I never heard from Nikki again.
And I spoke to Daytime Tea Time only because the story that Daytime Tea Time had originally got wasn't the truth. It wasn't all truth. And I didn't want her to put out no lies. I didn't want her to put out no lies on them or myself. So yeah, I spoke to Daytime Tea Time and it didn't get a whole lot of traction that I thought. And, you know, I just tried to go on about my life.
I never said I didn't speak to Nikki. I said that Nikki did not call me and offer me money out her mouth.
Okay, got it. I got it.
She did not. Kenneth Petty didn't call me out of his mouth and offer me money. That's what I stated because I didn't want people to put words in my mouth. I didn't want people to say that I was insinuating something that wasn't factual. I was just letting it be known that this is what occurred. And I know people want to say, well, why you put Nicki Minaj in it? And I know she only said it because, you know, Kenny's with her. This only happened because Kenny's with her. Like, the nigga's been registering until he got with her. There was no issues until he got with her. So, it's, you know, people be like, well, why didn't you sue a long time ago? Because the nigga went to jail and I thought he was through with me. I thought he was done. Like, he was finished. He wasn't going to fuck with me anymore.
Talking to this YouTuber has worked. The marshals are investigating. There is an investigation going on. This is a high priority case for them. And they have found evidence. I cannot say much more, but when somebody tells you that they are being threatened, that they are receiving phone calls, and you think that somebody needs to lie about something like that, who would think?
She said, now they're gonna say that the Daily Beast was lying about the high priority case. But that they could possibly say that, because, you know, because I said I don't have a case against them. The U.S. Marshals is not me. I'm not the U.S. Marshals. You know what I'm saying? Like, I have no control over what they decide to do.
Right.
But as of right now, that I don't know anything about anything more than, you know what I'm saying, than you guys know. Exactly what I know, exactly what has happened to me.
And Hot Shot Radio Show from day one. So keep these in mind because you're going to see these come up again soon in the near future. And then he goes on to saying, we certainly they want to have her statement in an affidavit format, but all that can be discussed. The first step is to make sure you understand and are satisfied with the fact that you can no longer be prosecuted for recanting. Well, they were trying to put
and
on a hook.
That's what I want to say. That's why he was sent. He was there to give her, sent to her as a fact finder and investigate so that he's the third party that he's speaking to her with. I mean, he's the third party that they're going through with. He was hired. Okay. So he also states that she can have a lawyer that's knowledgeable of New York's laws, meaning not New York's laws. He's talking about New York laws of recanting statements and making sure that she won't have to do any time for recanting her story to assist with Mr. Petty, as I've stated for a long time, as I've been repeatedly stating here in this video yet again, that her
Black is the one who had the lawyers contacted me. Black is the one who had the fact finder contacted me. Yeah, I didn't know there was an investigative unit at first. I was told from Black just 10 minutes before, yo, you ready to talk to your lawyer? Then when a guy called me, that's why you see in the messages me asking those questions. Wait a minute, whose lawyer are you? Are you Black's lawyer, Kenny's lawyer, Nikki's lawyer? And that's when he let me know that he wasn't a lawyer. He was an investigator working for Kenneth Petty's legal team. But in his first message that he sent to me, he says, my name is Charles Middlestar, and I've been talking to Black. You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, you know, how much more connection can you possibly get? So when I go to the regular police, they're looking at me like, well, you didn't get a direct threat. You know, well, your brother can call in. And he's not going to call the cops. He's going to tell me, like, from a street perspective, yo, you in Georgia, just get a gun. Like, I'm not a street goon. I shouldn't feel like I have to go get a gun because niggas who I don't know is contacting family members.
She said, fuck Fendi, babe, I think she was playing. I heard she knew them things, I think she fucking Wayne. She call herself Lewinsky, that means she give them brain. She tryna be like Little Kim, her picture looks the same. Why she ain't signed with G-Unit, she from Queens, right? And what's her nationality, she Chinese, right? I mean, she okay, but she ain't all that. She ain't the next bitch, tell that bitch fall back. See, I'm a hater, I go hard, listen, let's begin. You know her last name, Minaj, she a lesbian. And she ain't never coming out, thick and currency. But every time she do an interview, you know I run the beat. She get me so sick and make me vomit. That's why I spend my time online leaving comments. And you know that I got some more haters with me. Might hit up this is 50. MTV hit a BET, telling pretty, please don't play Nicki. Still I rise, still I fight, still I might. Crack a smile, keep my eyes on the prize. See my haters, tell them hi. One day you remember this, one day when we reminisce. Nothing I do ever is good enough for the music biz. Still I rise, still I fight, still I might. Crack a smile, keep my eyes on the prize. See my haters, tell them hi. One day you remember this, one day when we reminisce. Nothing I do ever is good enough for the music biz. For you.